Amen. We praise God again for being here. Thank God for all that has taken place thus far in His name. It's good to see you in the house one more time. Isn't it good to be here? Isn't it a blessing to be in the house of the Lord? Thank God for this choir singing that medley, taking us back a little bit. We appreciate that. Thank God for all of you that are here, visitors, friends, members, all that make up this wonderful congregation. Amen. I still have to say, as I look out among you, you're still the greatest church this side of heaven. Amen. God couldn't have planted a better church, a better group of people loving the Lord. And I thank God for each and every one of you. Amen. Thank God for you. But stand to your feet right now as we get ready to receive the word. Amen. I know our hearts have been blessed already by what has taken place. We're hoping and praying that the word encourages us today and blesses us. Amen. 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 Let us bow our head for a word of prayer, and then we'll get right into the message. Dear gracious God, again, we come humbly before you, Lord, realizing that all our strength, all of our help comes from you. And so, Lord, we pray now that you would just strengthen us, Lord. Touch our ears, that we, first of all, touch my mouth, Lord, that I would speak your words and speak them clearly, understandably, Lord, so that we can receive them. And then touch hearts, Lord, so that we receive your word today, receive what you have for us individually and collectively, Lord. And then, Lord, I pray that we would follow what your word says. Just give you thanks now for your powerful, life-giving word. Speak through me, Lord. For it's your word that sets the foundation. It's your word that destroys the yoke. It's your word that gives life, Lord. So speak your word through me, Lord, your living word. I just give you thanks right now for all that are here. Bless, Lord. Some need to be delivered from things, Lord. Deliver. Some may need to be saved. Save in this place. Whatever needs to be done, Lord, we're just asking you to do it now by your glory and by your power, Lord. So we give you thanks. We give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray, Lord. Amen. 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 You may be seated. You may be seated. You may be seated. We're going to try and tie up the theme that we've been talking on for during this season of Lent. Thank you. We've been talking about, if you caught it several weeks ago at the beginning, we've been talking about sacrifice that counts. And if you take, I hope and pray you took some notes. If you didn't take any notes, then just get the DVD and tell them I say give it to you for free. Because I want us to all be on the same page when we talk about sacrifice. Because during this season of Lent, as I've said over and over and over, we've talked about several topics on sacrifice that counts. And this is a time, as we know, in Christendom, in the Christian realm, where people sacrifice and do things to deny themselves. But even more importantly, this is a time where we in Christendom focus toward the cross and the tomb of Christ more than ever before, more than probably any other season of the year. We really take a good look at the cross and the tomb. We focus toward the cross and the tomb because they represent they just represent so much to us. They're so meaningful to us. They represent the greatest sacrifice that anyone has ever made on our behalf. The greatest sacrifice. The cross and the tomb together, they pose a dynamic, contrasting picture. From one perspective, the cross and the tomb represent sin, suffering, shame, humiliation, represent death. It really represents the worst of mankind that could happen to mankind. But conversely, at the same time, the cross and the tomb represent unwavering love. They represent humility and sacrifice, obedience. And of course, the cross and the tomb together represent victory and life. It's the best that God could give to mankind, the what happened at the cross and what happened at the tomb, the best God expression of his love towards us as mankind. And so we've been laying a foundation and on sacrifice that counts, been trying to build kind of a stairway to get us to where we need to be so we can understand this principle. Sacrifice we looked at in Genesis between Cain and Abel from their story. We looked at that sacrifice, first of all, must come from the right kind of heart. You have to have the right kind of spirit. You have to have a humble heart. You have to be open and receptive to God, obedient to do the things that God has called us to do. We have to be willing to sacrifice, first of all. And then that sacrifice, it's got to be the best we can offer. We can't just give God anything. I know some people do, but we can't just give God anything, not just something, but it has to be something of value. It has to be quality. It has to mean something to the giver. And in order to prevent us from being confused by looking around, looking for something good enough to give God, you know, going in our bank account, going in our closet or whatever, looking for something to give God, we just went straight to Romans 12:1, where Paul urged us and said, "Brethren, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your bodies a living sacrifice," and letting us know that that's our reasonable and acceptable service toward God. And so we just want to cut to the chase and say, if you're looking around for something to give God, just look in the mirror. Give him yourself. Amen. Tell your neighbor, give him yourself. That's what he wants. He really wants you. He doesn't want you. He doesn't need your money. He doesn't need all that other stuff. He just wants you. And so give yourself to him. So Paul encouraged us and said, give ourselves to him. And when you give yourself to God, there's no way you can go wrong on your offering. There's no way you'll go wrong, because God says, I won't throw it away, I won't cast it out. God says, I can do something then when you give yourself to me. And then last week I kind of added another kind of addendum on there, free of charge. I was trying to encourage the young people and those of us, those in the congregation who may still be unmarried, I was trying to encourage them not only to give their bodies to God, but to keep their bodies to themselves and for God only until they are married. Now, I said it last week. I know it sounds like an antiquated concept that went out with the 60s back in last century, 1960s, when most of y'all too young to know, just probably me and Brother Conway, the only one to remember. But when, you know, the love era, you know, peace and love, and just love the one you're with, you know, and throughout all kind of morals, everything was on. So I know that sounds like an antiquated concept to try and get the young people to live holy before God and keep themselves pure before God. I know that's old-fashioned, but I believe that that's the best response that we can give to God, that young people can give to God, is to show them that I'm going to keep my body pure for you, Lord, for you to use. I belong to you. I don't belong to myself. Lord, I belong to you. And I believe that's the best response they can give to God and before their peers, in showing their peers that in this depraved and sexually immoral world that we live in, that there's still a remnant of young people who will live holy for the Lord. Amen, somebody. I knew it wasn't going to fly. It went over like a lead balloon last week, and I know, you know, we kind of like I said, some people just give up on it, you know. And you know the reason why we kind of give up on our young people? Because we remember what we did when we were, I didn't mean to go there on us. Yeah, we remember what we did when we were young, and so we give up on them. But I believe that we ought not give up on them. There's still hope for our young people. So, yeah, I'm encouraging them to live to themselves, to live for God and keep their bodies to themselves until they are married. Hello, I got three amens. I guess that's all I needed was three. One for the Father, one for the Son, one for the Holy Ghost. Y'all, I know y'all not going with me on that. That's all right, though. I know the Lord is with me on that one. So today I want to touch on, go a different direction, touch on a concept that goes hand in hand with sacrifice of ourselves unto God. It's necessary if we're going to sacrifice and give all that we have to God. And that concept that I want to talk about today is commitment. Commitment. Anybody know anything about commitment? Yeah. Commitment, sacrifice that counts. We're going to talk about commitment today. Commitment to Christ, commitment to what we believe, commitment to what we say we believe, and commitment to what we preach, commitment to what we're supposed to be doing, supposed to be about as Christians. True commitment in our lives before God and before people makes all the difference in the world. You won't believe how many people you will touch if you show how committed you are to what you say, to especially to Christ, especially to the things of Jesus. So whether or not a thing is going to succeed or fail is really based on the commitment that's put towards it. If there's little commitment, it probably won't succeed. If there's great commitment, it will probably yield great success. And so we want to talk about commitment today. Is that all right? Yeah. Tell your neighbor we're going to talk about commitment. Yeah, just right at the top of the paper, commitment. Now, commitment is a word or idea or concept that seems to me, it seems to have lost a lot of its, or a lot of its power, a lot of its meaning in this day and age. Commitment. We shy away from commitment in this day and age. And we're going to see why in just a minute. But let's refresh our collective memories on the meaning of commitment. Commitment from the dictionary, it's an agreement or a pledge to do something now or in the future. It's an obligation. It's an agreement or a pledge. A commitment is established based on the individual's word, his word. Somebody say his word. It's based on his word, it's based on their promise, or their voluntary agreement to obligate themselves to a cause, to a person, or to a task. It's voluntary that they've given their word. It's not under duress. Nobody twist your arm for a commitment. It ought to be voluntary that we commit. So it's a promise to fulfill an obligation. So commitment is a concept with which most of us are very familiar. That's why so many people refuse to commit themselves to anything. Hello, somebody. Because they know what a commitment requires. A commitment requires that we stay true to our word. A commitment requires that we honor the whole agreement. A commitment means that we do our best to fulfill it, to keep the obligation. We do our best, even if it takes us out of our comfort zone, even if it may cause us harm in some way, not physical harm, but we may have to spend more time. It may cost us money, but a commitment means that I'm obligated to fulfill it. Are you with me? And so that's why many people don't really get into a commitment or hold true to their commitment. They don't want to obligate themselves to a commitment. And in this world, especially here in the United States, they seem to, maybe it's all around the world, I don't know, but I hear about it all the time about men. Men more often than women have been portrayed as having commitment issues. Whenever it comes to a relationship, they say the man has commitment issues. He doesn't want to commit. And from a man's perspective, these commitment issues are justified. Listen to me now. Listen to me. Yeah, I said they're justified from a man's perspective, because listen, when he finds that certain young woman and he may be interested in her, and then you know they go on the first date, and then you know it's now she wants him to commit to a monogamous relationship, which is fine. I think that's nothing wrong with that, but she doesn't want him to look at, talk to, be seen in the presence of any other woman unless she's there. So that's the first step. Then she wants him to commit to being there whenever she calls, whenever his phone rings, whenever it beeps and texts, you better answer the phone or else. She wants him to commit to celebrating Valentine's Day, Sweetest Day, the first month anniversary of when they met, the first month anniversary of when they went on the first date, I don't see any of the women smiling because they know we're telling the truth. You don't remember what day this is? This is last month. Last month? What was it? I can't remember yesterday. And so you got to commit to all that. You commit to the anniversary of everything. You got to commit to stop hanging out so much with your buddies. She said that was top on her list. You got to commit to, you know, to put the toilet seat back down. You got to commit, make a strong commitment when she says something about taking the relationship to the next level. That's when she's soliciting a real commitment, because then she's talking about, honey, you got to put a ring on this thing. And most of the time, the man realized from the beginning that this is where it was going in the first place. He knew that all that old little commitment stuff about the anniversary of the first date, the first kiss, the whatever, all that was just the tip of the iceberg. And there's much more stuff that he's expected to commit to. And we realize that from the beginning. Men aren't dummies. I know y'all think we are. You think we're crazy, but we're not dummies. We knew what was happening. And like any reasonable, clear-thinking man, when he hears the word commitment coming out of a woman's mouth, his first instinctive reaction is to run the other way as fast as he can. I said any reasonable, clear-thinking man. Hello, somebody. I didn't get any amen from the men. All the men just holding their head down. Afraid to say anything. That's all right. I'll say it for you, because you scared. I'm not scared. Not really. But ladies, I do want you to understand something. Men aren't really afraid of commitment. That's not the real issue. Men commit all the time. We commit to going to the job, working a job, working 40 hours a week. We commit to paying the house note. We commit to a whole lot of things. So men are not afraid of commitment. The reason why that man getting into that relationship may want to run, it's not because he can't handle the commitment. The problem is that he doesn't want to disappoint that special person in his life. Oh, y'all didn't buy that one. Oh, no. I thought I had them, man. I thought they were going to buy that one. But seriously, though, we don't want to disappoint that special person, that other special somebody, that woman, that wife. We don't want to disappoint them, because if we fail in any area, if we break our commitment or don't live up to our commitment at any time, we're going to hear about it over and over and over. Don't let us do it twice, because if we do it twice, the second time is going to trigger what happened the first time. Don't do it the third time, because the third time is going to trigger what happened the first time, the second time, and men, y'all just as scared as y'all can be. I got one brother raising his hand over. He know I'm telling the truth. So it's not that we... Put your hand down, man. I want you to... I've been watching that. I watch every now and then the... what's that show on TV? Oh, I can't remember it right now. But anyway. So we don't want to disappoint that woman in our life. And so it's not that we're afraid of commitment, we're afraid of committing to too much. But the point is, everybody knows what commitment is, and we know what commitment means. And sometimes you can accurately gauge an individual's character by what they are committed to or to whom they are committed. So I want us to kind of do a self-assessment right here, right now. You assess yourself and I'll assess me, okay? So the question I want to put on the table is, what are the top priority commitments in your life? What are the top priority commitments in your life? Which commitments to you are 1, 2, and 3? Is it family, wife, husband? Is it children, church? Is it your profession, your job? Is it yourself? Is it friends? Is it school? Is it your personal appearance, your physical, you know, physique? What is it? Is it your car? Is it your house? I don't see anybody writing anything, but I want you to think in your mind. What is 1, 2, and 3 in your life? 1, 2, and 3 in your life. 1, 2, and 3. That commitment list says a lot about what you value in life. And I'll ask the question today, where does Christ fit in that list of commitment? Is he really at the top? Is he really at the, I heard somebody say yes, yes, and I heard somebody say he should be number one. There's no doubt he should be number one, but where is he really? And since we're here in this place, since we're in the house of God, and since we're part of the body of Christ, and many of us call ourselves followers, and if you're a follower, Christ is supposed to be the number one commitment to whom we committed in our life. Am I right about it? And so let's look at what Jesus expects of our commitment. Because I hear y'all saying that he's number one, right? Anybody want to take that back? Because we have a litmus test here. Jesus gives us a litmus test on whether or not he is number one. Look at Luke 9:23, if you don't mind. Luke 9:23. He says, Jesus was speaking to his disciples, and he said unto them, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. If any man will come after me, if anybody's going to follow him, take up his cross, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Jesus lays out the commitment that he requires from his disciples or his followers. In this verse, he gives three specific requirements. He first of all says, deny ourselves. Deny ourselves, deny ourselves, deny the one that we think the most of in the world, deny the one that we've been pampering all our lives and trying to get it their way all our lives. That's us. So he says, first of all, deny yourselves. Then he says, take up the cross daily. Somebody say daily. Daily. Yeah, take it up daily. And then he says, follow me. So just looking at this list of three things on face value, it looks like it could be a heavy burden. It could be an overwhelming commitment. But Rick Warren says in his book, Purpose Driven Church, he says, the stronger the commitment required, the stronger the commitment received. In other words, if you ask people to only give a little bit of a commitment, that's about what you're going to get. You're going to get a little bit less than a little bit. But if you ask people for a great commitment, you'll get something a whole lot bigger and greater than a little bit of commitment. So the bigger the commitment asked for or required, the stronger the commitment will be that's received. So this looks like a big overwhelming commitment that Christ asked. But let's look at it. But no doubt Jesus puts on the table a strong commitment. He puts it before us. But it's not as overwhelming as it looks. It's not as overwhelming as it looks. Let's hear what Jesus says about his expectations of us. He first of all says, deny yourself. What does that mean? It means we have to let go of a self-centered mentality that thinks we are that the world ought to revolve around us. Come on, somebody. You know, that's the way a little baby thinks. That little baby, hasn't experienced much of anything. That baby is dependent on people around him. And so that baby, whenever that baby needs something, what does it do? It cries. It hollers. It doesn't get up and go get its own milk, go get its own food, doesn't change its own self. No, it cries and expects somebody to come and change them, feed them, see if they're all right. And so that's what a baby does. That baby thinks everything revolves around it. All I have to do is cry and holler, and it's all about me. But Jesus said we have to learn how to get rid of that self-centered mentality that thinks we're the center of the universe. We have to get rid of that thinking and realize it's no longer about us only. It becomes the Lord It becomes who Christ is in our life. In other words, our saying ought to be, Lord, it's no longer my will, but thy will be done in my life. Lord, it's what will you have me to do? Lord, I give myself away to you so that you can use me. It's giving ourselves, it's denying self and looking out for the things of Christ. Are you with me? Yeah, because a lot of times flesh or the natural man is very selfish. And so we have to put him out of the way, because if he's up front, if he's the highest priority, then we're going to continue to do things to satisfy self and forget about other people. But we deny ourselves of things when we put other people and put what Christ says in first place. When we put our appetites of the flesh, the craving of a polluted mind, when we put that aside and we allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us in the personal issues of our lives, that's when we're denying ourselves. We have to learn how to hear from God, because God says, I want to be with you, I want to be in you, I want to use you, I got things, great things I've got in store for you. But when we're centered around self, what I want to do, what I think I'll do this, I'm going to do that, when we got I in the way, Jesus is not on the center, not on the throne in our life. And so he says, first of all, we have to deny ourselves. Tell somebody, you got to deny yourself. It plain and simple, you have to deny yourself. I know you pamper yourself in the morning, wake up and you take a nice warm shower or bath, and you have the best soap, you have the best lotion, and you do, oh man, you put on the nicest clothes, you love to pamper yourself. Nothing wrong with that. But when you get out of the mirror, you got to put Christ first. Hello, somebody. You got to deny yourself. Ought to look good when you step out, but then it comes about, then after that, and that's good. That even reflects on Christ, because Jesus doesn't want somebody coming out with hair on, I combed it this morning, with hair on comb, crusty lips, you know, sleep still in the corner of your eyes, and you know, bad breath and all. No, that's a bad reflection on him. So it's good that you pamper yourself in that way, but like I said, once you step out of the mirror, step out of your bathroom, come out your front door, it ought to be about Christ. Are y'all listening to me? So he says, first of all, learn how to deny yourself. Learn how to tell yourself. Three people said that. Learn how to tell yourself no sometime. It's not, speak to yourself, tell yourself, man, it's not my will. I've got to do it. Y'all ever talk to yourself? I thought I was the only crazy one up in here. I guess everybody, you got to tell yourself sometime, back up, take the back seat. Jesus is driving this car. So first of all, we have to learn how to deny ourselves, withhold some things from ourselves. And then secondly, he said, take up your cross. Take up your cross. When? Every day, not just on Sunday when it's come to church Sunday, not just when it's revival season or crusade time. No, he says, take up your cross daily. Take up your cross daily. Understand this one thing. God does not, when we think of taking the cross daily, and we see the portrayal of Christ carrying his cross down the cobblestone streets of Jerusalem, we see him all bent and broke down and beat up, and some of us get that kind of picture of carrying a heavy cross. But understand, God does not want us bent over, broke down, looking pitiful to the world. So that's not what he means. So get that picture out of your mind. That's not it at all. So when we take up our cross daily, it reminds us of something. When we take up our cross, it reminds us that our old sinful nature has been crucified with Christ, and that our old sinful nature is no longer in charge of our life. Yeah, Galatians 2 and 20 says this, I'm reading NIV, it says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And so he's realizing that he died on the cross with Christ, his natural man, his old sinful man. And he's saying, the life I now live, I live in Christ. When we carry that cross, that reminds us that our old man is dead. It's been dead, it's died, and it was buried on the cross with Christ and in the tomb with Christ. And so we no longer live to self. Now we live to Christ. So taking up our cross daily reminds us of what has already transpired spiritually in our life. It means that now all I have to do is trust Christ to lead me, to protect me, to empower me, to supply my every need. Taking up the cross daily means doing everything or doing the work that Christ has called us to do. That's what it means to take up the cross daily. It doesn't mean just to pick up your Bible and read it and fold it, you know, and then go back to cooking or whatever. But it means actually ministering. It means allowing ourselves to be used of God. Are y'all listening to me? It means ministering to people, helping the downtrodden, teaching and mentoring our children in the ways of Christ, taking care of our seniors and the disabled, visiting the sick and the shut in, strengthening families, making a significant difference in our community because we are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. It means making people's lives better with a smile, with a hug, with a kind word, with a helping hand, just being nice to people, just loving on people, just being kind to those that are especially around us. That's what taking up the cross means every day. If you're walking around with a frown on your face and you can't say a kind word and everybody has to speak to you first, you're not walking around with the cross of Christ. You're walking around with a chip on your shoulder. And you need to get rid of the chip and pick up the cross, because the cross reminds us of the sacrifice Christ made for us so that we can be Christ-like to everybody we come across. And so taking up our cross means taking up where Christ left off in the earth realm and being good, healing people. And understand, the Bible says that even a merriment, even laughing and just getting people to laugh helps heal the body. And so we ought to show people a smile. What they say, it takes less muscles to smile than it does to frown. I am taking my time. I just feel this thing, that's all. I just want you to see that commitment is not as big and bad as it may say. It's not as burdensome as it sounds. So he says, first, deny self. There's a lot of things we need to deny in ourselves anyway. We need to push back the plate every now and then. Yeah. We need to turn off the TV every now and then. On Wednesday night around 7 o'clock, when you're supposed to be at Bible study. And somebody told me Bible study last week. They said, Pastor, got good news. The last episode of the season ended this Wednesday. I said, praise the Lord. Maybe I get some people back in Bible study. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I still got a message I'm going to preach on Empire, though. Not on that show, just on Empire. Okay, amen. Yeah, I feel like Jesus in the garden. They just, Bible student just, whoom, just, yeah, we used to have a classroom of students back down there, and now where we meet? We meet in front of the fireplace and fire. Because the Empire, but Lord have mercy. Anyway, how did I get off on that? I'd have lost my place. But denying ourselves, so we need to turn some things off for the cause of Christ. And then take up our cross daily. It's not just on a weekend thing, it's daily. And then he says, follow him. Deny yourself, take up your cross, and then follow me, he says. And so back in the day, I remember a song that the old folks would sing. How'd it go? It said, where he leads me, we'll follow. Where are those anointed fingers I need right now? Where he, what's the house say? You need more than anointed fingers. Anyway, but there was a song that they used to sing, where he leads me, I will follow. And that's what Christ is saying, follow me. David, as a shepherd boy, penned in the 23rd Psalm, he penned these words and said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Look what he says. He makes me to lie down in green pasture. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. David's saying, the Lord has been leading me everywhere I go. The Lord leads me like I'm leading these sheep. And David was saying, wherever the Lord leads me, That's where I'm going. I will follow him. And that's what Christ is saying to us. We just simply need to follow his lead. Hello? Just follow his lead. And if you let Christ lead you, he'll take you to places where you've never been before. If you let Christ lead you, he'll open up doors and take you up elevations that you never thought you would ever be in. He'll lift you up. If you just let Christ lead you, he'll do things for your family, for Lord have mercy, for everybody around you. If you just let him lead you into those wide open spaces, into those green pastures beside the still waters, all that represented prosperity. Green pastures represent prosperity. Green, green, green. Anybody need to prosper in some green? Y'all know what I'm talking about, some green backs. Let God lead you. Don't follow the world's way of doing, but let God lead you. And by the still waters, that represented refreshing and rejuvenation, the water. Anybody ever need to be led somewhere where you could be rejuvenated and refreshed? If you follow Christ, he will breathe on you and refresh you. And so we need to learn how to follow after him, because wherever he leads, I'm saying in my spirit, Lord, I will follow. And if you let Christ lead you, he'll take you before presidents and kings and dignitaries. I know what I'm talking about. Or he'll bring presidents before you even. Wait till I see our president. I can tell him I knew you when. We called. Never mind. Let me be quiet. No, I'm serious about that. We knew him before he was president. Hello, somebody. But if you trust God and follow after Jesus, he'll open doors you never thought you would ever walk through. Yes, he will. I know he will. So you ought to know by now that God has a way of making a way out of no way. He can see down the road where we can't see at all. We can't even see around the bend. God's already looked down the road. He's seen the end of the road, and he knows where it's going. So that's why we ought to follow him. He knows where the road is going. So just trust him. He'll lead us through the darkness of the night. He'll lead us through the blinding light of the day. And but we need to just follow him at all times in our lives. And so these are the commitments that the Lord requires of us. Deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, and follow him. And then in the 19th chapter of Matthew, give me just a few more minutes. Can I have 2 more minutes? In the 19th chapter of Matthew, there was a rich young man that asked Jesus, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" You remember him, don't you? And Jesus told him what he needed to do if he wanted to be perfect. He told him, "You have to keep the commandments." And that's where he started. And the young man said, "What commandments?" He said, "Well, honor your mother, your father, you know, love the Lord, and so forth." And he said, "Well, I've kept all those commandments since my youth. What else do I need to do?" And to me, that sounded like a self-righteous spirit. And so Jesus, even though Jesus knew that this self-righteous young man had not kept all the commandments since his youth like he said he did, Jesus went a step further with his commitment and said, "I tell you what then, sell all that you have, give it to the poor, and then follow me. If you really want to do what's right, if you want to be right before God, if you want to be perfect, then sell all you have. Let go of your wealth, your money, all your material goods. Give it to somebody who can use it and who needs it, and then follow me." And he said, "You'll have your treasures in heaven if you do that." But the young man hung his head. He asked the question. He was the one that asked the question. When he got the answer, it was too much for him. He hung his head. He turned around and walked away because he was committed more to his money than he was to Jesus. He was committed more to his money than he was to people. And so he turned and walked away because he couldn't give that commitment to Christ. And I wonder how many of us that have things in our lives have made those things more important than the cause of Christ. I'm just wondering, because, you know, I'm not throwing off anybody else, because every now and then I have to check myself. What's really important? You know, what am I going to let take precedence over what I'm supposed to be doing for the Lord? So I just wonder how many of us, and like I said, we're evaluating ourselves today. But in Matthew 10:37, listen to this. They're talking about a heavy commitment. In Matthew 10:37, Jesus said this. I don't know if I gave it to her on the screen. But in Matthew 10:37, he says, whoever loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loves his son or his daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Jesus was soliciting a strong commitment from them. He was saying there's going to be a time that even if your family tells you don't serve me, that you're following the wrong one, he says that you got to love me more than you love your family. Amen. That's a deep commitment there. Because mom and daddy, those are the ones that we love, the ones that raised us, that cared for us. And if we start loving the Lord, I'm just saying from unchurched, obviously I'm talking about unchurched folk, but if you begin to love the Lord and mom and daddy tell you you're crazy, you're wrong, taking that money up there to the preacher, because I don't know why they always think you're bringing the money to the preacher. I don't even count the money, but, you know, well, you take that money up there to the preacher so he have a new car every day and all, every year and all this other stuff, and you're wrong. You need to put, and so they start telling, but you've got to stand steadfast because Jesus said, if you love mama and daddy more than me, you're not worthy of me. You're not fulfilling your commitment. Even your children, the most precious things we have on the face of this earth, he said, you got to love God, Christ, more than you love your children. Because if you love God more than you love your mama and daddy, more than you love your children, then you'll do right by mama and daddy every time. Come on, somebody. Because if you just loving mom and daddy because they mom and daddy, they're going to make you mad every now and then. And you're going to forget them. The kids, if you just loving them because of your child, sometimes I've seen people beat their kids like dogs. And they call that love. But if you love your child, if you love Christ the way you're supposed to, and then love your children, what am I saying? I done stepped in this one. You're not going to beat your child like a dog. Hello, somebody. Yeah, I said that. I didn't say you weren't going to chastise them, but you'll chastise them in love. And don't tell me this stuff is hurting you more than it's hurting me and you beating me half the... No, that... I can tell you something. If you are really living for Christ for real and it's not a show, when it does come to your family will realize that they could be the happiest people on earth if you are living for Christ before you live for them, because you'll do your best for Christ, and doing your best for Christ means doing your best for your family, for your mama, for it, your daddy, your children, for people around you. And so he says, you got to stay fast, steadfast with me and demonstrate my love to them. Demonstrate his love to them. So even though you love family and mom and daddy, and we do, we love mama, daddy, we love, you know, all our relatives and so forth, except the crazy uncle who lives in the basement down there. But anyway, we love all of our, that's fun, and I'm just fun, and everybody got one of those in the family, crazy auntie, crazy uncle, or somebody. But we love all of our relatives. Oh, you got two of them? Okay. Oh, daddy's whole side is crazy, huh? Okay, all right. You still love them, though, right? And we do love them. But we got to love them with the love of Christ. And I'm sure if you're demonstrating Christ, they'll appreciate you in the family. Hello, somebody. Because whenever tragedy hits, who do they run and get? There's somebody who knows how to get to God. I don't care how much the family has stayed away from God. As soon as tragedy hits, they come and get somebody who's got a connection, who's got a hookup with Jesus. Pray for us. Pray for the family. And so I know they'll be blessed. Even though they may go against you and talk about you and everything, stay with God and then love them with the love of Christ. Amen? Amen. Look at Matthew 11:28, and I'm going to close on this. Matthew 11:28. We know this one by heart. It's the Great Commission. Great Commission. This is where he also lays out a strong commitment. He presents the terms of his commitment. First of all, he starts off and says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So he's bidding us to come to him. And then when he says, when you come to me, look what he says. He says, take my yoke upon you, a yoke, and learn of me. "For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls." Go down to verse 30. Can you get verse 30 there? You're right. He first of all says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." And then he says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto yourselves." He says, "For my yoke is easy, and my burdens are light." Okay, my yoke is easy, and my burdens are light. He says, "Take my yoke." That sounds heavy, doesn't it? Anybody know what a yoke is? I'm from up north. I've lived up north all my life. But I happen to make a mistake and go down south a couple times, and I know what a yoke is. I've seen a yoke is a tool or a harness that's put on an animal. It's a harness put on an animal, a beast of burden, and it attaches them to the whatever the burden is, whatever the load is they're getting ready to carry, whether it's a wagon or a sled, you know, something to slide, a tobacco sled. Wagon tongue. That thing that flips out and you hook it onto there I've seen the Wild Wild West too. I've seen the cowboy. You know, when the horse tried to get loose and they jumped down on that thing in between the horses, that's the wagon tongue. And then the yoke is hooked to the wagon tongue so they could pull the load. Now he says, "Take my yoke upon you." That sounds like something heavy, doesn't it? Let's be honest, that sounds heavy, because a beast of burden, you put that on a beast of burden. And then he says, learn of him and so forth. But then he comes back to his yoke and this seemingly heavy burden, and he says, but it's his yoke and his burden. And he says, "My yoke is easy and my burden is what?
Light."
Is light. That sounds like oxymoron. When it seems to be saying the opposite thing in the same term, yoke is not easy, because I've seen the animal struggle to get started, and with that yoke on it, and the burden wasn't light. That's why they had the mules or the oxen or the horses pull. It wasn't light. But Jesus says, "My yoke is easy." Did he say it was his yoke? Oh, man, maybe that's the key then. Jesus says, "Here, take my yoke, it's easy. Take my burden, it's light." So how is that possible? How is his yoke, how is his burden, yoke easy and his burden light? Causing me to think. I look at it and I see his yoke that's going to be pulling the load. It's easy. Why is it easy? Because to me, as I look at it, I look at the work that's to be done has really already been done. Remember when he hung on Calvary's cross? And he looked up and looked out around and said, "It is finished." He was speaking about his work in the earth realm was finished. So when he commissioned us to take up his burden and put on his yoke, I'm looking here that he's telling us it's his again, right? He's telling us to take up what he already did and follow him. The work was already done, and we're to walk in his work that he's already done. Well, somebody said there's still souls to save. There's still people. Well, he's already sent his word out before us to perform it. Because didn't he say, in my name, you shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Come on, didn't he say that? He said, in my name, you'll heal the blind. You'll restore people's lives. Didn't he say that? You'll cast out demons in my name. And so his word has already gone forth. And if you know anything about the word of Christ, it performs whatever he sends it to do. And the work, the heavy lifting has already, all we got to do is walk in it and claim it and say it and speak it. It's already done. That's why he says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Mm. And then I also look at it. I said, but Jesus, you got something else. You got something else. You got an ace in the hole back there. That, yeah, I understand that. But when you look at what we're to do, anybody in here, well, let me say this first. When he also sent us somebody, not a something, but a somebody who had just as much power as he has. In fact, if you really got the scripture straight, it was the Holy Spirit working in Jesus that enabled him to do what he did anyway. Come on, somebody. Because he came here like a natural. Oh, y'all. He didn't come as God. He had to rely on the Holy Spirit to do that through him. And so he gave us another comforter, another helper. He gave us the paraclete. That means one that comes alongside to help. And if the burden does get heavy, it reminds me of a weight. Anybody in here ever lift weights? I'm probably the only one in here that ever lift weights. y'all have a time to laughing at me, don't you? No, I didn't lift weights, but okay. But anybody ever lift weights? And you get on that weight bench, and you know you put about 200 pounds on there. You need what, Brother Tim? You need a spotter if you want to be safe, if you don't want to hurt yourself. And you try and go to your limit, and you start lifting. If it's right at your limit, and you have your arms can kind of get wobbly before that'll come back down. And so you're laying on the bench, and there's somebody at the head of the bench where you're lifting, and they kind of spot you. You go ahead and pull it off, and you got it. And they, you know, and you push it on up. You know, you want to do how many reps do you do in one setting? About, it's been a long time since I did it. You know, I don't remember the number. You do about 10. So you put 200 pounds on there, and you, one, whoo, yeah, two, whoo, three. You just throwing it up to five, six, seven, eight. And they saying, come on, come on, you can do it. You can do it, man. You can do it. You can do it. And you get that eighth one. Come on, man, just two more. You can do it. And that ninth one starts to wobble, and they kind of just put their hand under there a little bit. And you get that ninth one up there, that tenth one. Oh, Lord, you start, oh, Lord, 10. And they just put their hand under there again, and it seemed like it that load gets, and all they're doing is putting their fingers under it. They're not lifting it, and they just help you out a little bit, and before you know it, you got that 10th one. Whew, and it's up. They helped you with that heavy load, okay? The paraclete, the helper, the one that Christ sent back to help us. When the load gets too heavy and he sees us start to struggling with it, he said, wait a minute. The Lord said, that's easy. It's not heavy. He steps in, and what we're struggling with, he applies his power to the situation, and what may seem heavy to us all of a sudden becomes light because the Holy Ghost steps in and said, let me help you with that. And he does the heavy lifting. That's why Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burdens are light. Because he knows that we have a helper, the comforter, the Holy Spirit with us. If the burden never gets too heavy, just call on Holy Ghost. He can handle it. He can handle it. He'll lift up that heavy burden. And so I look at that and I said, thank you, Jesus. He just makes it, oh, Lord. But he's asking for a commitment. And Jesus never asks us to do more than what we can. He knows we can handle it. How does he know we can handle it? Because the Holy Ghost is on the inside. And greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. And so no matter what you're facing, just trust the Lord. Trust the Lord, and he will see you through. You'll be able to lift it. You'll be able to handle it. All he's asking you to do is just commit. He's saying, trust me. I've got all that handled. Just trust me. Don't look at the way it may look, because a whole lot of folk make this Christian thing look real hard. According to the face with the frowns and all that. Oh, Lord, you know, I got to do this, got to do that. No. That's not what it's all about. When you're doing the work of the Lord, there's some joy. There's a whole lot of joy in doing the work of the Lord. I have to admit, I have to confess, I saw somebody in the hospital this weekend, and they said, and they weren't in there, they were visiting their sister. She's here today. And she said, Pastor, you here at the hospital? I said, yeah. She said, because the last time you came to visit me, you told me that you didn't like going to the hospital. It just did something to you. It seemed like you felt it so hard and so much you didn't like going. I said, yeah, but I had to get over that. And in trying to get over that, I talked to Reverend Baskin, and he said, yeah, that's just a ministry. That's just, you got to get over that. You got to put the people first. It's just a love. He loves to do that. And I started hearing him explain it. I said, yeah, it's not about me feeling bad. They're the one on the hospital bed. It's about them. So I had to learn how to put self out the way and trust God. And so that was heavy lifting for me. Because it seemed like I could feel their pain, Reverend Bradley. They talk about they got cut. Now it just, oh, Lord. You know, But I'm past that. And I thank God that I've learned how to embrace the fullness of the ministry. Because if we can't go and minister somebody because we got to hang up, there's something wrong with us. And so I found out that even that burden is light. And I realized that if Jesus can do it, we can do it. Because he's already paved the way. It's already done by faith. All he's asking us to do is walk in it. Walk in it. So my question today is, what commitment? How deep of a commitment? How big of a commitment, how heavy of a commitment will you give the Lord? He's committed, he was committed to us when he came down here to this earth. He committed everything he had towards saving us. The Father was committed to us. He gave his very best that we would have a right to the tree of life. My question on the table today is, what are we going to commit to the Lord? And I know most of you are saved in here. I know that I'm not even questioning your salvation. I'm just questioning our commitment. And I said our commitment. Not pointing fingers, I'm pointing fingers at Richard. What is our commitment for Christ? He said we need to learn how to deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, and follow him. And when we do that, God somehow works everything together for our good. It won't be burdensome. It won't be heavy. It won't be taxing. He works it out for our good. Do you believe that? Amen. Do you believe that? Come on, give him some praise in the house then. Bless God. Come on, stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. What will the commitment be? What are we going to commit to him? Been really trying to get us to focus on, to really look at things in light of what Christ has done for us. He's done so much for us. He's done everything for us. Everything, everything, everything. The breath we breathe, the blood in our body, the health we have. I just thank God every day for my health and strength. Not running as fast as I used to, not moving as, none of that is like we used to. And my daughter even says, Daddy, I hope I don't get to the place where I'm walking like you. And what you talking about? I thought I was walking pretty good, you know. And she said, no, I hope I don't get to walking like, she said, because Daddy, sometimes you don't know it. You walk bent over, Daddy. And yeah, when I get up, every now and then when I get up, the knees are kind of stiff. I'm going to admit that. But I still thank God for the health and strength that I have. Lord have mercy. Some days I feel like I can run out there, I kid you not, and try out for the Bears foot, no, try out for the Bulls, no, try out, and help these kids on the Little League team. That's, but I thank God. I thank God for what He has done. God has just been good to us. He's committed totally to us. Committed totally to us. He's committed totally to us. What can we give back to Him? That psalmist asks, "What shall I render unto the Lord for all of His benefits unto me? What shall I render?" And he went on to say, "I'm going to praise Him, I'm going to honor Him," and so forth. But what are we going to give back to the Lord? What can we commit to Him, especially during this season of Lent? What are we committing to Him? Last week, challenged the young people to live a chaste life. And then I, in reality, we know that some of them have crossed the line. We know that. But I made the statement that God specializes in making old things new again. He's the one that renews our status. And I put it out there that if you just ask God, he'll renew you. He'll make you brand new again. But I'm asking for that commitment and a bigger commitment to God. And I just want all those who want to be renewed in their life in Christ, who want to renew their commitment to Him, I just want you to come forward today, right now. If you don't have to do it, you know, it's not a show of spirituality and all that. I'm not looking for that. But just if you just want to touch and agree with others that want to step out and show, hey, I'm recommitting, I'm rededicating. I may have, you know, gotten off the straight and narrow, and I put God second, third, fourth, whatever, but I'm recommitting to put Him first in my life. If that's you today, I just want you to come forward. If you're here today and also you want to be saved, I want you to come forward. If you're willing to put Christ at the forefront of your life, I want you to come forward. If you want Christ to make you over brand new and just those sins, those things that you have done, you want to make sure they're under the blood, and they are if you've already asked Him. But if you want to be new in your body, I talked about virgins last week. And even though you may have made a mistake, God is able to change you, change your heart, change your spirit, change you on the inside, where whatever mistake you made has no effect on your life. He'll make you over a brand new vessel, if you allow Him. So if that's you here today and you want to recommit yourself, rededicate yourself to the Lord, won't you just come on forward? We just want to pray with you real quick. Just want to pray with you. Not going to send you through. Not going to ask you what you're praying about, what you did. No, that's between you and God. But anybody want to rededicate themselves, recommit themselves during this season of Lent, in looking at the cross and how He committed Himself to us. Thank you. Amen. Call of salvation also being extended at this time. Is there one that will come to Christ? Give your life to the Lord. Is there one? Call of membership. If you need a church home, we invite you to make this ministry your home. If you need a church home, won't you come? Amen. Amen. house. Bless God for you. Bless God for you. Call of salvation. Anybody feel the call of life, call of the Lord on your life? Amen. 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 God bless you. You may be seated. Let us